whole city of Shenzhen is a very young city. The average population is something like 33 years old. The city itself has a 43-year life. So it's very young. It's constituted mostly of migrants. So we have very short history. We forget about the failures. We are almost like the Western, you know, especially the Silicon Valley environment. You can just, you know, take all the risks, and if you succeed, we'll remember you. If you fail, you're gonna start again. We'll forget it.
喺睇片之前，大家记得分享、赞好同订阅卓见名家，最紧要揿埋呢个钟仔，咁你就唔会错过我哋嘅最新影片。
And indeed, we take Hong Kong UST as our role model in establishing the Southern University of Science and Technology. So in the next 15 or 20 minutes, I'm going to go through the things that we were trying to do. You can see that we draw a lot of wisdom and inspiration from what our peers, big brothers and sisters in Hong Kong, are doing. So my speech will be entitled Cultivating an Innovative Ecosystem in China's High-Tech Hub. What makes Shenzhen unique? Shenzhen is just across the river. We are one of the first special economic zones in China, pioneering reforms and opening up. It's still a window for China looking outside at this time. It has proximity to Hong Kong and Macau, and which makes it a very enriching land for science, technology, and also for global financial resources. It's a very vibrant business place, especially the private sector in China. And you probably have heard about this, famous slogan: "Time is money, efficiency is life." 时间就是生命，效率就是生命. That's actually started from Shenzhen. It's also increasingly an innovation center of China, thanks to the risk-taking and failure-tolerant environment, because the whole city of Shenzhen is a very young city. The average population is something like 33 years old. The city itself has a 43-year life. So it's very young. It's constituted mostly of migrants. So we have very short history. We forget about the failures. We are almost like the Western, especially the Silicon Valley environment. You can just, take all the risks, and if you succeed, we'll remember you. If you fail, you're gonna start again. We'll forget it. As a result, the place has already been a high-tech hub in mainland China, with over 24,000 high-tech companies, including about 300 of them surrounding our campus. The city spends about 5.5% of its GDP on research and development. I was told that this is probably the highest ratio among all the mainland Chinese cities. The city, as I mentioned, is about 45 years of age. Most of the institutions in the city has a history of less than 30 years. The first one was established as Shenzhen University, and the second cohort, including some of the universities represented in today's symposium, like Peking University and Tsinghua University. We are among the latest additions. And also CHK has very generously lent hands to the development of Shenzhen by setting up its CHK Shenzhen campus. So the university was formally established in 2012 with the original intention to become a research university with high starting point and high positioning, and also to pioneer the education reform in mainland China. It has two missions. The first one is to explore the modern university system with the Chinese characteristics, which becomes increasingly important even today. The second one is to explore the training model of innovative talents. It has about three development stages. The first one is the exploratory and establishment stage, which lasts about 4 years, with the formal establishment and approval of the university by the Ministry of Education in China. And the second stage is what we call a rapid development phase, which lasts until about 2020, when it achieved its first 10 year of formal history. And the third stage is last 3 or 4 years, which we call a high quality development phase. And the university has a few important milestones listed on this slide. I will not elaborate on them. Some of the key achievements, again, we try to become a world-class university by attracting the best talents. We are invested a lot by the Shenzhen government, a few dozen billion RMB invested already, and continuous generous support by the local government. We are at the heart of the Great Bay Area, which means that we draw a lot of resources from the industry innovations. And also we have been very fortunate to have learned from the role models in Hong Kong and many other places by setting a very formative and flexible governance structure, including a very powerful International Advisory Council. Many people here are the International Advisory Council members for our university. And also we have a very strong network, global network. About 90% of our faculty have studied and worked extensively abroad. I have worked about 15 years at Harvard and Oxford before returning to mainland China. And just a few remarks on the so-called Lianghui, the important parliament meetings that occurred about a month ago in China. This National People's Congress meeting and also the National, the Chinese People's Political Consultory Conference meeting. In Chinese, we call it Ren Da and Zheng Xie. These are the two chambers of the Chinese parliament. And in that meeting, the premier, Mr. Li Qiang, delivered his work of the government report. And it listed all the important challenges externally and internally. I would not go through the list, but you can see that China does face a lot of challenges going forward. But because of the challenges, we also should pay attention to the opportunities. And there are quite a few of them. For example, we have vast market demand because we have about 1.4 billion people altogether. We have a very complete industrial system to ensure the supply, which is not going to be too disrupted by the change of the global supply chains. And we have a huge and high caliber workforce. We have the capacity for science and technology innovation, which continues to grow. We have new industries, new business models, and new growth drivers, which are expanding at a faster pace. We have internal drivers for development, which is what we're going to talk a little bit about, the so-called new productive forces. And also we have the underlying trend for economic recovery and long-term growth, which remains unchanged. So a little bit about this so-called new quality of productive forces. In the morning, several speakers mentioned this. I think there's an important triangle, the education, science and technology, and talent building. These together constitute the new quality productive forces. We think that some key ingredients include the workforce, which is going to be more highly skilled, the means for production, which would be more technologically advanced, and also the object of the labors, which we're going to see wider range of the applications. I'm not going to talk about this, but I was a member of the CPPCC, so I brought in some of the proposals, policy proposals, during the two sessions. Again, for the interest of time, I'm not going to talk about it. So let's go to what SUSTEC aims to educate our talents. There are a few things that we want to do. We want to educate more scientists that can focus on key scientific problems. We want to educate top-notch engineers that will focus on core technologies. We also want to educate innovative entrepreneurs that can crack key technological problems, and also competent managers that can excel in modern governance. So we have, like the other two peers that have just got on the podium, we have extensive collaboration with the industry. Some of the companies that we work close with, particularly those in the Great Bay areas, are listed on the screen. I'm a board member for Ping An Group and Shunfeng Express, and about to become a board member for TCL, which are some of the key drivers for technological progress in the Great Bay areas from the mainland side. The university has also recently been chosen as a a member of the National Program for the Schools of Excellent Engineers, one of the 24 schools, and also we became a member joining the network of the National Reform Project on Engineering Postgraduate Training. This is one out of 30 programs. We have been very closely following the local government's call for strategic focus on the 20 strategic industries and 8 future industries in China, so-called 20 plus 8. And as a result, we have been spending a lot of efforts on building 10 major research platforms. And also some other major centers, particularly the one that's in Hetao, which is neighboring, joining the Shenzhen and Hong Kong area, which would facilitate scientific exchanges between mainland and overseas scientists. We have a number of joint labs with enterprises, and we are working very hard to bridge the gap for science and technological innovations to achieve industrial commercialization. And we have started to generate some incomes because we are only 13 years old. At this point, it's about 2.2 billion RMB per year on research income. Technological transfer within China, we have been progressing pretty steadily, but compared to many of the peers here, we're still lagging behind. So that's about it, about the science, Southern University of Science and Technology. Again, we are a little brother. We want to work hard. We want to learn from each one of you, and we would like to extend more collaborations with all of you. Thank you so much for the opportunity to talk about us. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor Jin.
鍾意名家分析，记得俾 like 同埋分享，支持同订阅卓见名家，最紧要揿埋呢个钟仔，咁就唔会错过我哋嘅新片。